results which we have seen are not the end of the story because we are heavily analyzing. I have to say that we have received only a few days ago the very last version of recalibrated and cleaned data. So the search for, in particular, pulsars and stochastic, but also for supernova explosion, is something which is really ongoing now. And, okay, what is the basic problem of this kind of sources, which I've called continuous sources, which means that they are sources which emit for very long times compared to the typical observing runs. So their signals stays there for months, years, and so on. So it's very different from transients. And I have started, this part of the slide. So continuous signals are emitted by compact objects. They can be isolated or in binary systems. And the problem is that the duration, okay, are very long, and this makes the analysis quite complicated in the sense that you have to integrate for long times, and so you need a lot of computing resources, and in any case, you need to wait for the end of the run to analyze the data. And but the strain amplitude, the expected amplitude, are much weaker than those, for example, from a compact binary object. This is, say, just an order of magnitude. So 10 to the minus 26 compared to 10 to the minus 21, just to give you an idea of the problem. Okay, so a distance like 40 megaparsec, which you know is close enough for a detection, so it's close to us if we have in mind the compact binary coalescence, is very far for this kind of searches. We are basically actually limited to our galaxy and nothing more. The search, as I have anticipated before, needs huge computing resources. Well, it depends on the parameters of the search, so on what you need to exploit. We have frequency solution, we have the position in the sky, orbital parameters in case of neutron stars in binary systems. Let me repeat, these are far enough from the coalescence that they are orbiting and meet a very weak signal, and we have to track it. We know, and this is the importance of this research, that many potential sources of this kind exist. In our galaxy, more than 2,000 neutron stars have been observed, but we know that something of the order of 1 billion exists in the galaxy, but simply have not been seen from an electromagnetic point of view. So they do not emit in the radio, for example, or have not been observed. And in fact, you know that every some time there are new detections. No? Very recently, yesterday or 2 days ago, a new gamma pulsar was observed by analyzing the Fermi data using the frame called Einstein at Home. And this pulsar is particular because it does not emit in radio, but in gamma, yes. So it's a field in continuous evolution. And I want to stress that the multi-message astronomy is very important also in this case. So the role is completely different because we don't need the low latency, for example, at least in general, but we need someone who, for example, tells us the parameters of the pulsars which have been observed, like Vela and Crab, because we need to know the ephemerides, we need to know if there is a glitch or not. But I will tell you later that there are other information which we might receive from the community and which will be very important for us in order to reduce the parameter space of the search, and thus having a fixed computing time or computing resources enhance the sensitivity. Okay, so this is a typical scheme, okay? The stars might be either isolated or in a binary system accreting matter. In this equation, we have the typical amplitude on Earth, which the typical amplitude, say, which might have at a distance of 10 kiloparsec, if this is the inertial moment at this frequency, and let's say 10 to the minus 27, and this is a parameter which is very important. It is the ellipticity, which tells you how the star is deformed, because the deformation in the crust of the star is what matters to have something emitted. If this is zero, where zero, then no signal is emitted, even if the neutron star is very rapidly orbiting. Then the underlying mechanism to the deformation can be very different, and is clearly different depending on the nature of the star. You can have deformation due to elastic stresses on the crust or due to a magnetic field, so the so-called magnets are very important to this field. You can have deformation due to accretion, free precession, or to the excitation of unstable and long-lasting modes like the so-called R modes. In the analysis, we have to consider the fact that the signal, which is quite monochromatic at the source, so it's a frequency which linearly decreases, for example, is modified on Earth by the fact that the Earth moves, and then we have the Doppler effect. And this is the fact which makes the search computationally heavy in case you don't know the position of the source, because you have to define a grid, divide the sky into many, many, many grids, and then do the search for all the positions by removing differently the Doppler effect for each position in the sky. Different situations and different, given the fact that we have not detected any signal so far, what we do is to put upper limits. And the upper limits are typically put having in mind the so-called spin down limit, edge based limit, or torque balance limit. So depending on the scenario which we have in mind, if you consider that the total emission is due to gravitational waves, in all cases, this is the amplitude of the signal which you receive. So the basic idea is what happens if what I observe, which is different in the three cases, is due to gravitational wave emission. And clearly, this is a very optimistic value. We need to go down. And this is what we have done, for example, in these two cases. So in case you know the frequency and the frequency evolution, then you can use the so-called spin down limit. Okay, so what if the total spin down is due to emission of gravitational waves? And this is the value. In case you know the age of your source, like for supernova remnants, but you don't know the frequency because you have not observed any pulsations, then you can use the age, which is here in the equation, to give an estimation of what you would observe. Let's consider that this analysis is, say, relatively easy in the sense that you know the frequency and the frequency evolution and you know where the star is. And in this case, you can do an analysis which optimizes the signal to noise ratio. In this case, the fact that you don't know the frequency makes things very hard. You know where the source is, because, for example, Cassie, you know where it is because the supernova remnants, the supernova was observed. But you don't know the frequency, and so you have to span the full frequency range of your detector, and typically what we do is that we do analysis where the sensitivity is better. And in case of a star which is receiving matter from a companion, then there is the so-called torque balance limit. So again, what happens if the frequency evolution which you observe was completely due to emission, to the fact that the star is receiving matter, and so enhancing the angular momentum, but emitting gravitational waves, and so you have an equilibrium. And in this case, this is the value. And this is, for example, the case of Scorpius X1, which is the closest and the brightest X-ray emitter on which we have done analysis. Okay, this is just to give you an idea that unfortunately we have not done any detection, and so we don't know. We have only theory and a few observations and a few, say, also motivations related to the equation of stars, possible equation of stars or neutron star, on what the values of this ellipticity might be. Say, in the case of a standard neutron star, this might be of the order of 10 to the minus 5. the higher is better. So we are very happy. We were very happy when Nathan Johnson and Ben Owen published this paper, because they studied the possibility of having quark stars. In this case, the ellipticity quoting them is expected to be very huge, so 10 to the minus 1. So this is very good for us. Okay, but we don't know if this is possible. In case of a magnetar, so in case you have a deformation due to a magnetic field, the ellipticity is proportional to the square of the expected, of the internal magnetic field, which is clearly something which is impossible to estimate now, but could be constrained in the future combining our information and other information, because if we can measure this parameter, we can give some constraint on the magnetic field. Okay, so I wanted just to say that in case we know how the star rotates, we can have an estimation of the expected gravitational wave frequency. Here I have written, say not equal, how do you say in English? Not completely equal, okay? Because clearly these are models, and we might want to explore, and this is what we do, the possibility of having gravitational waves not completely related to the rotation frequency, but with some mismatch, because this is clearly something which is possible. Okay, what could detections tell us? Well, many, many things. Equation of state, maximum ellipticity, sorry. Information on the magnetic field, as I told you before, information on accreting mechanism, possible accreting systems, also something on the Newton star demography. So, do we have a gravitar population? Gravitar are the neutron star whose frequency emission is, energy decreasing is totally due to gravitational waves today. Okay, and clearly we can also test GR. So this morning Giovanni told you about a few possible GR tests, mainly done with BARST, but they can also be done clearly in this case. We can also test the different polarization states and so on. It is important the fact that the signal stays for a very long time, and this gives us the possibility to do many, many things. Clearly, in the case of a non-detection, we cannot exclude equation of states, but we can say something because we can constrain other parameters, like what I told you before, the magnetic field, because in the case of a magnetar, the ellipticity is proportional to the square of the magnetic field. On the other side, and this is what I told you before I would have said, we can receive information from observation related to gamma or X-ray emissions. This is something which probably many of you know much better than me, and from results from gamma emissions obtained with SWIFT. So in the case the magnetar engine the engine was due to a magnetar, then there is a clear relation between the spin period of the newborn magnetar and the strength of the magnetic field internal to the magnetar. And this is, okay, I don't want to explain you all the details because this will take too much time, but I just wanted to tell you that in case from this kind of observations, these dots are the observations, so the observations done by SWIFT, if someone can tell us, okay, this is the magnetic field and this is a possible spin period, so then we can limit our research to this, okay, parameter space. Okay, then the other search, this is something which I can short a bit because Matteo told you before. Another important possibility is the search for post-merger remnant. And we have already done, as Matteo has said, searches for signals of very short durations, shorter than 1 second, shorter than 500 seconds. But we can even expect, depending on the nature of the remnant, we can even expect a stable neutron star, and this implies that it will emit always, but also a magnetar which emit the signal for hours or one day. I have to say that I think that concept with new optical observations and radio observations, which are being done now in this, started again a few, I think 1 month ago. Probably our colleagues are able to tell us the nature of the remnant, but I don't know. And in any case, given the fact that we cannot be completely sure of what models are, this search is something which we are doing right now. We don't expect any detection just because 40 megaparsecs is too much, but we want to be ready for other situations, and in any case, we think that we have the data and we have to explore also this possibility. Okay, this is another version of the previous slide. The presence of this plateau tells clearly something, and from this light curve observations, from this observation, our colleagues can probably tell us if this is not the August signal, this is another example, what is the nature of the remnant. Because, for example, note that these are 1,000 seconds, and these are order of one day. Okay, so the scale here is completely different. So this slope and the time related to this curve, the duration of the plateau and the nature of the plateau might help us in knowing what is the remnant and so how to do the searches. A short review results. Okay, this is a result on an upper limit on known pulsars, so pulsars for which colleagues gave us accurate ephemerides, something like Crab, Vila, and a few others which are known. We were able to go put a limit which is lower than the famous spin down limit, and this is an important thing because, okay, it's not a detection, but it's something which constrains the characteristic of the source and can be also stated in terms of a limit. So we have upper limit also on these parameters. Then we have done another search, on which I will skip, which allows some mismatch between the rotation frequency and the gravitational wave frequency, and we also have results for non-pulsars. And this is the results of the unknown all-sky search, so where we don't know where to search, and we have put again upper limit. This is the amplitude, this is the frequency. This search was done up to 500 Hz, but then we have also done searches up to 2 kHz, which simply we have not plotted here. Different pipelines, because in this case the situation is so complicated that in gravitational waves, this is typical, we have different pipelines which makes different assumptions, but in particular they behave differently in terms of sensitivity and robustness, because you need to be sensitive, but you also need to be robust. This is something similar to coherent wave burst and the templated search for the let me skip this because I think I have no time. This was clearly explained by Matteo. And then let's move to the other important search which we are carrying on and for which we don't have detection results, but clearly this is what is expected. But okay, something which is very, very interesting. Okay, you know that we have a stochastic background of two different natures. One is due to the sum of all these events, like the August event, also, or the event of the first detection. So colliding black holes, or colliding neutron stars, or supernova explosions, or neutron stars which are there and emit. And this makes an astrophysical background. And then we have the stochastic background, which is the echo of what has happened immediately after the Big Bang. We have searches clearly for both, and I have to say that in case of, okay, surprises, we cannot say anything, but to our knowledge today, the better expectations now are for an astrophysical background of binary black holes or binary neutron stars. Okay, the problem is the signal is very weak, is continuous, like the signals of continuous pulsars. So here the work, the characterization, the background characterization work is very, very important. reference. Funziona?
No, è morto.
Parlo con questo. Okay. In both cases, so cosmological and astrophysical, can be modeled in this way. You have a reference frequency, and then this alpha parameter, whose value can be 0 for a cosmological background, 3 for an astrophysical background, and 2/3 for compact binary model. So the analysis is based on something which looks for laws which might be like this, which seems to be quite simple. What are the results? We have also here different pipelines. One is based on an isotropic hypothesis. So we expect that this background is isotropic, so the same everywhere. No evidence of this background was found, and again an upper limit was put, and this is the best upper limit in the frequency region from 20 to 86. Stated in this way, this says almost nothing to you, but I have a plot which shows how this compares with expectations. But I wanted to say that in the three different scenarios, so three different values of this spectral index, which are for different hypothesis, we have different results, which are these values. So you see here something of the order of 10 to the minus 8, 8, 9, okay, which compared to previous results, which were the results obtained with the old detectors, are typically much better. Okay, this is the important plot. So here you can see expectations and results. Okay, so concentrate here, this blue line, this is the result of which we are talking. So the two LIGOs, because Virgo was not in operation when the analysis was done, O1 data, the O2 analysis is still ongoing, and you see, okay, this seems to be very, very narrow because the frequency range here is very huge, because we wanted also to put LISA, cosmic microwave background, CMB, slow run inflation, okay, so this is not so small. And then you see that the sign sensitivity, we will have the blue, sorry, we will have this, okay, and this is the important one. You see this light green and purple plots. These are the new expectations for an astrophysical background of binary neutron stars or binary black holes. New is including the new rate estimations obtained with the detections of LIGO and Virgo. And you see that the advanced design plots almost arrives here. And this is why we say that we expect that the sign sensitivity with 2 years of data, because this are done for 2 years of data, we can reach this limit and detect this background. While for the cosmological background, we think that we are still very far and we need other detectors. So this is something expected for the future. I have quite done. Okay, this was just a zoom, so I can. Then we have another search which I wanted to point out because it's based on a completely different method, still looks for stochastic searches, but assuming non sources. So it is something which does searches also around the positions, at the positions of important points in this, like SCOX-1, the remnant of the supernova 1987, and the galactic center, which is expected to be very fully populated. Working in this way, the result of this pipeline, which is called the directional for this reason, might also be used to detect the possible continuous wave, like the ones which I have described before, because the method is completely different from the one applied and described before, but can be done to look for emission also for given sources. And the result is the production of maps like this one, Okay, where here this scale card, okay, this means that there is nothing. So no signal was found. But suppose that at some point here, for example, we had seen a red dot, okay, then that would indicate the presence of sources or high dense sources there. So this method is also very important. My conclusions, I wanted to say that we live exciting times also if we ignore the detections, because we have made a lot of progresses in all the directions, and that to go ahead in the better way we need the work of guys working the experiment to improve the quality of the data, people who do data analysis, improving the algorithm, and a lot of theoretical work, and a lot of connection with the enlarged multi-messenger community. Okay. Thank you.
So thank you, Pia. We have time for two urgent questions. Yeah, one.
Did you compt CL to point angular point correlation function compt for the last part of your talk and the shear the V modes? It is possible to consider also the frame of cosmological scales the cosmological.
Clearly uses the so-called overlapping function, which considers the expected difference in the two detectors due to the shape of the background which you expect. But so far the only analysis which have been done with the model of a frequency evolution with this power alpha, so something which is, say, simplified probably, but should work in this frequency region. Given the fact that we are so far from expectations, unless we have some, say, new model which is worth exploring, okay, then, okay, we have not done. I remember that in the past, about many years ago, there was a new model, string model by Gabriele Veneziano at CERN, for example, and they told us that this model would have been very interesting, but many years ago, at the time of bar detectors. And so, well, we did an analysis using that model. So if we will have good models, okay, why not? We can try. But it's not what we have done now.
Other questions? Well, I have a curiosity. In the plot of the backgrounds, the cosmological backgrounds, the background from binary black holes and neutron stars are two nice lines, but how much the previous one?
Yes, no, this is a show, but okay.
Yeah. I suppose there is some uncertainty on the two lines of the binary black
well,
holes. How large is the uncertainty?
Yeah, well, no, this is, I think, the something which now is our best 90% estimation given the rate which we can expect. But the problem is that this is going to be modified in case of, okay, depending on what will happen. So that's why we are so confident, because we tend to be optimistic in these times. And so we think that with the new observation, probably this will increase. But suppose that during O3 we will not see anything, and then we'll go in the pessimistic region, well, this probably is going to move down. The problem is that these estimations have been done using different models, but using basically six detections, no? The five black holes and the one binary neutron stars. So I think they are going to change, yeah.
Thank you. So let's thank Pia again.